But you're a sociologist and a lawyer who's been working in the new study, the research and study of new religious movements for the last 3.5 decades.
Yes, I believe I have mostly focused on my academic career on the subject of new religious movements and Western esotericism and Eastern Asian religion. So that's the fields I have mostly written about. But it's true that my generation of scholars of religion was more encyclopedic, and I did write an encyclopedia, like Gordon Melton and other colleagues did, while today the young scholars tends to be very much specialized. I mean, something studying Scientology will tend to study only Scientology and not care very much for other new religious movements. While in when we started the academic study of new religious movements 30 years ago, we tended to deal with all new religious movements with some sort of more ecumenical gaze. There is a large difference between studying movements of the past. You cannot interview them. And I have colleagues who have tried to write excellent books on movements of 2,000 years ago, but you can only deal with the archives. But if you study, particularly from a sociological point of view, contemporary religious movements, I believe the received wisdom in the field of social sciences is you cannot study them only through books. You should actually go around and visit their place and interview their members, and to the extent they want to talk, also interview their critics and hostile ex-members, knowing that they have a bias, but that doesn't mean that you should not get familiar also with their criticism. So the work of the scholar of new religious movements, which means movement which are not defunct, they are still active, involves traveling and going and seeing and photographing a lot, which again doesn't mean that the scholar of new religious movements can ignore the written text. This is a mistake young scholars sometimes make when they say, let's do field work. Field work is very good, but many new religious movements are quite voluminous, sometimes a little bit boring, sacred scriptures, and you are supposed to read them as well. Mark Twain called the Book of Mormon chloroform in print. It's not a very titillating book, but I don't see how you can study Mormonism, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, without reading the Book of Mormon. But one advantage is the Book of Mormon is very small. Recently, I started studying a millenarian Shia movement in the United Kingdom, and they sent to me their Bible, which is nearly 700 pages.
Is there particular things that that draw the media attention or the law onto specific groups?
The media approach is different from the scholarly approach. I mean, the media are about selling, so they should isolate the details which can appear as scandalous or sensational. But there are many other details the scholars are interested in and the media are not interested in at all. But I would say that overwhelmingly I was always surprised that the persons who decide to embrace a new religious movements are normally just plain and ordinary people. there is nothing identifying them as cultists. I mean, they are ordinary people who have decided that a certain religion for them makes more sense than, say, Catholicism or a Protestant church. But apart from that, many of them are very normal lives. And I remember when I was just starting this work, I was taken by a colleague to visit polygamous splinter groups of the Mormon Church. You know, the Mormon were polygamous since until 1890. Then in 1890, one of their prophets had a revelation that they should stop polygamy. That also allowed Utah to become a regular state of the United States, them to enter the mainline American politics. But of course, as always happens in these cases, there were some traditionalists who wanted to maintain the old way, and there still are. There are polygamists. Some of these polygamists have committed crimes. I'm not talking of them. I visited a very quiet, rural, polygamous community. And then I and some colleague, we started asking questions, and we realized the questions were kind of stupid, because we are asking these people, do you have phone lines? There were no cell phones at that time. I say, yes. Do you use credit cards? I say, yes. And in the end, they became quite upset. Say, look, we are just normal folks. The only difference is we have more than one wife. But apart from this, we live like our neighbors. So we drive cars, we use credit cards, we use... So there are, of course, traditionalist groups like the Amish. They don't use the electricity or the cars, but that's their specificity. But in many cases, and the Amish are an exception because they refuse the modern technology, but in many cases, members of new religious movements are just like everybody else. I remember I was very surprised. I've written several books on the Jehovah's Witnesses, in saying Italian Jehovah's Witnesses, just like all other Italians, are very passionate about football. So you can break the ice when interviewing them, when discussing football. And of course, a journalist or perhaps an anti-Catholic say, well, these people are very much interested in the end of the world. So perhaps football is just something they should not be interested in. But in reality, they are, and they are interested in discussing cards, in discussing food. So they're just plain normal people, except that their interpretation of Christianity and the Bible is different from Catholics or Protestants. So of course there are exceptions. There are groups dressing in very original garb, like the Hare Krishna. But even the Hare Krishna, which sometimes don't dress as Hare Krishna, some of them are have regular profession. One I know is even a university professor, member of the Hare Krishna movement, and he doesn't go to teach dressed as a Hare Krishna. So even the Hare Krishna are kind of normal folks, and that I believe will be the big surprise for the media, if they really care. Many years ago, a leading journalist told me that there is a general principle in the media that sex sells, and illicit sex sells very much. So if a group experiments in alternative forms of sexuality or eroticism, and the two things are not exactly the same, chances are that the media would create scandals about them. And also, we mentioned before the anti-cult movement. The anti-cult movement is very much focusing on groups promoting alternative forms of sexuality because they try to use to support their theory, which is false, by the way, that there are more cases of sexual abuse in the new religious movement than in society in general or in mainline religion. This is not true. There are not only more pedophile priests than pedophile cultists, because the Catholic Church is much bigger than any so-called cult, but also in percentage there are more cases of pedophilia in the Catholic Church and in some other mainline religions than in the small religions. So, but the anti-cultists are very much attached because, of course, that sensational that supports their proposals for new laws, they're more very much attached to this false idea, demonstrated false by sociologists 20 years ago or 30, particularly by Andy Shoup, who died some years ago. But they are very much attached to the false idea that cults are more prone to sexual abuse than other religions. And so particularly the groups who have teachings or alternative teachings about sexuality, they believe they are a good place where to find sexual abuse. But the definition, of course, of sexual abuse in this case is a little bit twisted, because of course it is possible that religious leaders, as I say, both in mainline churches, and we saw many cases in the Catholic Church, but also prominent, for instance, Jewish rabbis, it's possible that religious leaders sexually abuse their followers. And in this case, in real cases of rape or force, they should be treated like any other defendant. They're not protected by religious liberty. But it's an entirely different matter if the anti-cultists argue that any form of experimentation with alternative forms of sexuality in new religious movement is in itself an abuse, because this is again false, and they have interviews, scores of women, not to mention men, in new religious movements that go there because they are interested in experimenting with alternative forms of sexuality, and very happy to do it. And they knew it before, and they embraced these teachings and practices. And here we have a very peculiar and fascinating phenomenon. I'm not the only one who has studied it. A prominent Swedish scholar called Henrik Bogdan has studied the same phenomenon in connection with groups originating from the teachings of the British esoteric master Aleister Crowley. And here is the point that Western societies are very tolerant of alternative forms of sexuality. I mean, take France in the 1950s, there was a novel, and in the 1970s, I believe, or early 80s, a movie, very successful, called History of O, about a woman who entered into a contract where she surrendered her body totally to a group of men to have some extreme sexual experiences. And the book and the movie were hailed as very progressive, about a brave woman challenging the moralistic conventions of society. And France, of course, is the country where the swingers clubs were first legalized. So you can experiment in alternative sexuality and get away with it quite easily in modern democratic societies, not in Russia, for example, but that's not a democratic society. And You have a modicum in democratic society of freedom of religion. I have been in this business for years, so there is much less freedom of religion than we believe, but of course there is. Unlike in Russia or in China, for unconventional beliefs, you can perhaps somebody cannot rent you a room in an hotel to give a lecture, but you don't go to jail or are executed, which can happen in China. But the two things together are not tolerated. In other words, if I experiment with some non-conventional form of sexuality and call it a sex club, it's okay. But if I call it a school of sacred eroticism or spirituality, it's not okay, because as Bogdan before me studied, there is this strong taboo, and that exploded against Aleister Crowley during his lifetime in the 1920s. You cannot put together religion and exploration of alternative sexuality. I mean, this exploration is allowed if it's called secular. But if you call it religious, immediately there is a very strong reaction against the taboo of mixing religion with sexual experimentation. And that's what we are seeing in the reaction against many groups stigmatized as cults, like Scientology or Jehovah's Witnesses is strong, but it's particularly strong with groups which propose tantric teachings or other teachings about sacred eroticism, such as the Guru Yara path in the Czech Republic, or Misa in Romania, or more recently the group of a shaman called the White Wolf, Luc Blanc in France, which really was not primarily about sacred eroticism, but one of the different teachings imparted to, after all, to a small group of students were about tantra and eroticism.
So, if I understand you correctly, you're saying when a government organization or the law basically comes down on one of these groups or investigates one of these groups under the auspices of finding sexual abuse, they're more looking for a reason to interrogate and persecute these groups and to stop their teachings?
Well, the argument which is used, and we see it at work in cases which I have written about, let's take the Guru Yara and the White Wolf in France, we should go back to the idea of brainwashing. Because in these two groups, there were sexual or erotic initiations, and most or in some cases all or almost all women went through these initiations. They didn't complain, actually they requested them. And in some cases, only after a few years, they left the group, they started reading anti-cult literature. So say, now I understand that it was consensual, but my consent came from brainwashing, didn't come from my free will. And so the long and the short of the story is, again, brainwashing. So if a woman, but in some cases a man, there are even cases of female leader imparting sexual initiations to men, if a devotee surrenders in a way his or her body or sexual freedom to submit to a sexual initiation, the question is it possible that this is a free choice? And of course, many people would answer, yes, I have, as I say, interviewed dozens of women and men who went through this path and were very happy about it. But the theory is, since this, according to some ideas spread in our society, is totally illogical and irrational and absurd, if somebody tells you, yes, I voluntarily decided to go through erotic or sexual initiation with a spiritual master, that can only happen because somebody has been brainwashed. So at the end of the day, we are back to the theory of brainwashing. Then, of course, sometimes there is even worse, because there are stories where even the materiality of the sexual fact is not proved. There is a case going on in Argentina about a group called the Buenos Aires Yoga School. And in this group, there is one single anti-cultist who attended the school when he was a teenager and then left decades ago. And he keeps insisting that women are taught secretly prostitution, and then they work as prostitutes in this school. The problem is, all the women he indicated by name as prostitutes, they are middle-aged professionals, lawyers, accountants, real estate. You should be crazy. I mean, we never were prostitutes. What are you talking about? But still, largely for ideological reasons or for promoting an anti-cult law, the Argentinian police started an investigation, lost a case, and then they started another one. And then this investigation was so biased that it has been annulled by a court of appeal, but they are starting again. And this is a unique case, because in cases of that small group, in cases of larger movement, at least you will find among hundreds of women or men who went through sexual initiation, there will be 2, 3, 5 who will complain and say, after years, I realize it was abuse. In the case of the Buenos Aires Yoga School, there is not even one of the victims which will admit she was abused. But the more so, the police has examined tens of thousands of hours of teachings in the school, and I believe they found less than 10 minutes where the teacher discusses sexuality in very general and common sense terms. And these women unanimously say they never discussed the sex with the master, let alone being taught how to become a prostitute. And so this is, to me, is a totally invented case by one single individual, which has been picked up by certain prosecutors and politicians, actually, because it's used as a picklock to break into the general opposition the Argentinian society has manifested against an anti-cult law. So say, let's create, and they call La Secta del Horror, the cult of horror, in the media, and there is no cult. I mean, it's a guy giving lectures about Dostoevsky or philosophy every week in a restaurant. There is no cult, there is nothing. But of course, La Secta del Horror, or the cult of horror, sells well the media. And it is used to see, you see, we need an anti-cult law, because cults are so bad that we badly need an anti-cult law. Well, I wrote a book on Misa and Gregorian Bivolaro, and in this book I did two things. First, I tried to show that the teachings of Gregorian Bivolaro are not unique or strange, And of course, I did clarify that most of the teachings of Misa are not about sacred eroticism, but I could not avoid to note that the teachings of sacred eroticism are those on which prosecutor or the police and the media are most focused about. So, speaking of these teachings and clarifying that there are many other teachings in Misa which have nothing to do with sexuality or eroticism, speaking of these teachings, in the first part of the book, I clarified that they are not isolated, that there are dozens of schools in the world proposing similar teachings inspired on Indian Tantra, and a few of them have been discovered by the anti-cultists and targeted, and most have not. And also, I try to show that the teachings of Bivolaru and of Misa are rooted in an old Indian tradition. And I discussed the controversy because there was a period in which the scholars of Hinduism, they tried to sanitize Tantra by not talking about eroticism because it seems it was something dirty or pornographic. But today, that's old hat in the sense that contemporary scholars of Tantrism, of course, unanimously recognize that, again, Tantra is much broader than eroticism, but you cannot take away from Tantra the teaching about eroticism and particularly about continence or orgasm without ejaculation. And actually, as I show in the book, the cutting-edge research on Tantra in India is these are the oldest teachings, because there are other forms of erotic experimentation in Tantra, but they came later. Now scholars tend to agree that the continence teachings were actually the oldest nucleus of the Tantra. So the first part of the book is there is nothing particularly strange in the teachings of Bivolaru and Misa, and of course for the media they are very much strange. Even if we want to discuss this, in some media say there is also a big scandal in Misa that they mention some practice with urine. But again, practice with urine in India have been around for 2,000 years and possibly more, and there is a substantial literature of them. Now, we can believe, we cannot believe when practices with the urine are good for our health, that's another matter. But again, it's not surely not an invention of Bivolaru, and it has very old roots in Indian tantric, and even non-tantric in this case, Ayurvedic practices. So that's the first part of the book. And the second part of the book is to reconstruct, based on interviews and also based on written text, what Bivolaru and Misa teaches, particularly teach about sacred eroticism. And the center of all this is the distinction between sexuality and eroticism. With eroticism, whose sign is continence, but eroticism for Bivolaru is different from sexuality. Sexuality is either for reproduction or for the pleasure, while eroticism is a way to enlightenment. And also, the erotic practice in Misa is never separated from a number of other yoga exercises. You cannot go there and just do the erotic practice. You will not achieve anything according to the teachings of Misa if it's not combined with postures and with a number of other yogic exercises. And of course, the third part of the book is to deal with the controversies and reconstruct a legal story of MISA. It was written before some recent events, but I believe there is a key point which totally eludes the media, that since the time of Ceausescu in Romania, Bivolaru has often been accused of sexual abuse, which is the common accusation against tantric groups. But it has only been sentenced in one case, which involved a girl whose initials were MD. And MD was 17. And at that time, the legal age for having sexual relationship in Romania was 14 or 15. It was not 18. So those who mention pedophilia, of course, are totally wrong. But what happened is that Romania had a law prohibiting sexual relationship between a teacher and a student. And they constructed that a teacher of yoga is a teacher. Besides the fact that MD was not a direct pupil of Bivolaru, she had another yoga teacher in Mise. They say it doesn't count because Bivolaru is the head of the school, so it should be her teacher anyway. Well, MD later denied she had any sexual relationship with Bivolaru. She says she signed the declaration because she was threatened by the Romanian police after the big raid against MISA, and her version was deemed believable by the Swedish Supreme Court, where she testified when Bivolaru was granted political asylum in Sweden. But what is important here is true. Bivolaru has been accused of having abused women in different circumstances, but he had been found guilty by a court decision only in the case of MD. And that case of MD was not pedophilia, she was 17, was not abuse of a minor. She was major for sexual relationship under Romanian law. It's only based on the alleged teacher-student relationship. This is the one case in which he was found guilty and he got the exceptional jail penalty of 6 years, which was unheard of in Romania for such teacher-student relationship, even if it was true, and the Swedish Supreme Court said it was not true. In all the other cases, I insist, in all the other cases, the judges, including in Romania, concluded Bivolaru was not guilty. And some decisions are very strong against the accusers, saying these accusations have nothing to do with protecting victims, but they have everything to do with destroying a religious movement and the yoga schools. And there are, of course, pending accusations, including in Finland. From what I know of this case, this accusation seems to me a little bit strange. But anyway, these are pending accusations. So Bivolaru has not been sentenced for massive sexual abuse of women or for pedophilia. The only court decision against Bivolaru is for having allegedly had a sexual relation with a 17-year-old student. That's all so far. And of course, I cannot comment on pending cases because the documents of pending cases are largely secret. So I don't even know what he's exactly accused of. But I believe the media are creating the monster of Bucharest, like we had the monster of Florence in Italy, raping hundreds, some say thousands of women, while in fact the court records say otherwise.